shortly, I would request everyone to start taking their seats inside the hall, please. We are still waiting for the secretary to join us. His counterpart, Mr. Ian Wright, member of UK Parliament, is already here with us. You may like to bring in your cup of coffee or tea inside the hall. Gentlemen, we are going to begin about 2 minutes from now. May I request the volunteers to please have the people who are still outside to join us in the hall, please? Normally, we start our conferences at 9. ICC wanted everyone to be comfortable and beat the Bombay traffic and be here so that the hall is full when our secretary is here. I think they have been successful in that decision. I'm going to request Mr. Yogesh M. Kothari, President ICC, Mr. Rakesh Bhartia, Vice President ICC, Mr. Indrajit Pal, Secretary DCPC, Ministry of Chemicals and Fertilizers, Government of India, Mr. Ian Wright, Member of UK Parliament, Shadow Minister, Mr. Opar R. Gopalakrishnan, Director, Tata Sons, Dr. Raman Ramachandran, Chairman and Managing Director and Sub-Regional Head, South Asia, BSF India, Dr. Hans Jochen Korte, Executive Vice President, Solvay, and Chairman, RCLG, to please come on the dais. Mr. Gopalakrishnan should be joining us in a very short while, maybe 5 minutes from now. And with the permission of the chair, we begin today's program. Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. I'm Nidhi Varma from Elite Plus Business Services, your knowledge partner in Petrochem. It's indeed my great pleasure to be with you for these two very exciting days. And we at Elite Plus Business Services thank ICC to give us the opportunity to be their organizing partner for this very prestigious conference for the last 3 years. A very warm welcome to all fraternity members in attendance to the 7th annual India Chemical Industry Outlook Conference, organized by Indian Chemical Council in partnership with NEPIC. A gentle reminder of the salient features of the Competition Law and Competition Act, which is mandatory to be followed in all conferences. On the monitors. The Indian Chemical Council is the pioneering organization representing the interest of the entire cross-section of the complete chemical industry, bringing to one platform industry representing stock intermediaries, bulk petrochemicals, specialty chemicals, and products required by various verticals like pharma and agro-industry. ICC, in partnership with NEPIC and knowledge partners Frost and Sullivan, have put together an extensive two-day program which will cover a wide agenda encompassing global chemical industry, cross-border trade, specialty chemicals, international trade, and its impact on our Indian industry. The two-day event will add integration and feedstock challenges, R&D innovations, infrastructure, logistics, and most essential, responsible care. We have amongst us today leaders of the entire chemical industry. What better platform than this for providing our dear delegates a unique opportunity to exchange views with the movers and shakers of this very vital industry. It's my privilege to welcome Honorable Chief Guest, Mr. Indrajit Pal, Secretary DCPC, Ministry of Chemicals and Fertilizers, Government of India, Guest of Honor, Mr. R. Gopalakrishnan, Director, Tata Sons, Dr. Raman Ramachandran, Chairman and Managing Director and Sub-Regional Head, South Asia Pacific BSF India, and Mr. Ian Wright, Member of UK Parliament, Shadow Minister, Mr. Yogesh Kothari, President, Indian Chemical Council, and Dr. Hans Jochen Korte, Executive Vice President, Solvay. It's my great pleasure to have you all with us today at this very prestigious congregation. Few housekeeping rules before we really begin today's proceedings. Kindly put off your mobile phones to the silent mode. Please make sure you wear your badges around the conference area. There is a mini pad, iPad, to be won in the lucky draw at the end of day two. Eligibility to participate in the lucky dip is to fill the feedback forms, which will be picked up during the lucky draw in the evening of tomorrow. The emergency exit is as shown in the diagram. Now we begin today's conference proceedings. It's my pleasure to welcome our very own Yogesh Pai, President ICC, to deliver the formal welcome address. Mr. Yogesh Kothari is the Chairman and Managing Director of Alkyl Amines Chemicals. Mr. Kothari is a chemical engineer and it is graduation from University of Chemical Technology, UICT, Mumbai, before obtaining a Master's in Chemical Engineering and also studied his Master's in Management Science from University of Massachusetts, Lowell. After completing his education, Mr. Kothari worked for Uday, Germany, before coming back to India, where he worked with ICB India. He gained experience with stock brokers DS Prabhudas & Company and investment brokers DSP Merrill Lynch for a few years. In 79, Mr. Kothari founded Alkyl Amines Chemicals, which has now become a Rs 400 crores company manufacturing amines and intermediates. In the year 1999, Alkyl Amines Chemicals Limited, along with a partner, took over Diamines and Chemicals. Ladies and gentlemen, please put your hands together to welcome Yogesh Ji.
Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. Mr. Indrajit Pal, Secretary, Department of Chemicals and Petrochemicals, Ministry of Chemicals and Fertilizers, Government of India. Mr. Ian Wright, Member of the UK Parliament, Shadow Minister, Business Innovation and Skills. Mr. Gopal Krishnan will be joining us now. He is the Director of Tata Sons Limited. Dr. Ramachandran, Chairman and Managing Director and Sub-Regional Head, South Asia, BASF India Limited. Dr. Hans-Jürgen Korte, Executive Vice President, Solvay, Belgium. Mr. Rakesh Bhartia, CEO, India Glycols Limited, and Vice President, ICC, and distinguished delegates. I thank Mr. Indrajit Pal, Mr. Wright, Mr. Gopal Krishnan, and Dr. Ramachandran for accepting ICC's invitation and agreeing to speak during the inaugural session of the conference. I also thank Dr. Korte, Executive Vice President Solvay, who is the chairman of the Responsible Care Leadership Group, for his presence at the conference. I'm delighted to welcome all of you to the 7th Annual India Chemical Industry Outlook Conference, which is a signature event of the Indian Chemical Council. The theme of this year's conference is India and the Global Chemical Industry. This conference is organized in the cooperation with the Department of Chemicals and Petrochemicals, Ministry of Chemicals and Fertilizers, Government of India, and supported by the Northeast Process Industry Cluster, NEPIC, and Frost & Sullivan, who are our knowledge partners, and other partners. I'm very happy to note the response received from the Indian delegates as well as the overseas delegates for this conference. India Outlook conferences have been providing networking opportunities to the delegates to interact, share their views regarding the performance of the industry during the year and outlook for the industry in the coming year. I'm glad to welcome several of our past presidents. I can see Mr. Partha Sarthi and Mr. Hiremat and others who are here. Let me start by highlighting some of the developments and the initiatives that ICC has initiated during the last year. Responsible care. ICC is promoting responsible care to the Indian industry and recently received very positive support from the regulatory authority in the country. Gujarat Pollution Control Board has recognized ICC's efforts in promoting responsible care initiative to the Indian chemical industry, and GPCB has extended regulatory relaxation to the RC logo holding companies of ICC. ICC thanks GPCB for this and will take up with other state pollution control boards to enact similar policy decisions. This will definitely help members of the chemical industry to see very positive benefits in their commitment to RC. I'm very happy to inform you that ICC Aditya Birla Award for the Best Responsible Care Committed Company for the year 2012 is confirmed on BASF India Limited after stringent audit procedure involving interviews, the directors, and the site visits. I compliment BASF for the achievements, and the award will be presented during this inaugural session. I thank members of the awards scrutinizing committee. Welcome, Mr. Gopal Krishna. I thank members of the award scrutinizing committee who have painstakingly studied nominations and carried out site visits and discussions at various levels. I also thank Aditya Birla Group for sponsoring the RC award. The NYSA Globe project, which was started with the support of 7 founder members, in companies include BASF, Bayer, Clariant, Deepak Nitride, Dow Chemicals, Lanxess India, and Alkyl Amines Chemicals, with the Technopurple IT Solutions Private Limited as a technology partner. NYSA Globe is a significant step to address the industry's challenges in successful implementation of the transport, distribution safety, and emergency response with vision to enable chemical industry with global acclaimed standards, infrastructure, and services for safe and secure transportation. This project is now progressing well. I appeal to the industry to please take advantage of this initiative of ICC. ICC has also been active in promoting process safety and recently has conducted training sessions on risk-based process safety, which helps in preventing major accidents. You started a process safety center on for that. Skill development. In response to the Prime Minister Office communication and active support from FICCI Chemical Committee, ICC has taken the lead in setting up Skill Development Council for the chemical industry. For this, a separate operating entity is being set up. This will start operation in the next few months, and members will be informed about the future developments. Corporate social responsibility. The Companies Act has now been amended, and it will now be mandatory for the corporates to utilize 2% of their profits to a social responsibility. The various activities that are considered as social responsibility have been identified, such as promotion of education, ensuring environmental sustainability, employment, enhancing vocational skills, social business projects, etc. ICC is considering to set up a separate company which will help the member companies for discharging their corporate social responsibility for identified projects through the ICC channel. We are receiving excellent cooperation from in all our activities from DCPC under the leadership of Dr. Indrajit Paul, Secretary, DCPC. ICC is interacting at various levels with DCPC for communicating industry's views on national chemical policy, environmental laws, various FTAs that are being contemplated, WTO related discussions, various international treaties, etc. I'm indeed grateful to DCPC for the cooperation. The program of the conference has been well-structured, focusing on the various issues such as the global chemical industry, the cross-border trade relationships, convergence, Indian chemical industry overview, and the specialty chemical sector, trade treaties and their impact on the manufacturing in India, India in the eyes of multinationals, petrochemical industry integration, and feedstock challenges, responsible care, R&D and innovation, etc. And I'm sure that these 2 days will be extremely beneficial to update about not only the Indian chemical industry, but also about what is happening in other parts of the world. Please utilize the opportunity by interacting with speakers and networking with the delegate colleagues. In conclusion, we must remember that we are currently going through challenging times, and it is very important that we take time to appreciate this most essential industry, namely the chemical industry, to the fullest and make our utmost efforts to make this recognition to all our stakeholders. Thank you. I welcome you all again once again.
Mr. Yogesh M. Kothari, President ICC. Please present a customary bouquet of flowers to Mr. Indrajit Pal, Secretary of DCPC, Ministry of Chemicals and Fertilizers, Government of India. Mr. Ian Wright, Member of UK Parliament, Shadow Minister. A very warm welcome to India, sir. This is his first time to India, and I'm sure that we'll have a lot of visits after this one. Mr. R. Gopalakrishnan, Director, Tata Sons. Thank you for joining us today, sir. It's a great honor. Thank you, Yogesh Bhai. I'm going to request Mr. Rakesh Bhartia, Vice President, ICC, to hand over the bouquet of flowers to Dr. Raman Ramachandran, Chairman and Managing Director, BSF India. Dr. Hans-Jürgen Korte, Executive Vice President, Solvay Belgium, and Chairman, RCLG. Thank you, Rakeshji. I'm going to now request our Honorable Chief Guest, Mr. Indrajit Pal, Secretary DCPC, Ministry of Chemicals and Fertilizers, Government of India, to address our delegates. Shri Indrajit Pal belongs to the 1977 badge of the Indian Administrative Services, Andhra Pradesh Cadre, and has taken charge as Secretary, Chemicals and Petrochemicals in the Government of India in January 2013. He holds a postgraduate degree in Organic Chemistry from Delhi University, postgraduate diploma in Public Administration from Punjab University, and MPhil also from Punjab University. Mr. Indrajit Pal has held several senior positions in the Government of Andhra Pradesh and in the Government of India. Of particular relevance to his present assignment is his experience of about 9 years in various industries and industrial financing, 10 years in public health, and over 3 years in environmental management. Ladies and gentlemen, my privilege to present a fine policymaker, our chief guest, Shri Indrajit Pal. Thank you, sir.
Mr. Yogesh Kothari, President of the ICC, Mr. Bhartia, Mr. Gopalakrishnan, Mr. Raman Ramachandran, Mr. Ian Wright, and Dr. Kurte, delegates to the conference, captains of industry, ladies and gentlemen, members of the media. It gives me great pleasure to be here at this 7th annual India Chemical Industry Outlook Conference, organized by the Indian Chemical Council. The ICC, established in 1938, is the apex national body representing all segments of the chemical industry in India, and they have been interacting with the government in various fora for the benefit of the industry as well as the benefit of the policy that has to be formed in relation to the industry. The Indian chemical sector is very well developed now, with an annual turnover of about $120 billion in the financial year 2011 and 12. This, of course, includes the pharma sector and fertilizers and several industries allied to chemicals, not merely the core chemical industry. Given the availability of technically skilled manpower and low-cost manufacturing, India is a preferred preferred destination for knowledge-based and value-added chemicals. efforts are required for development of a number of basic and bulk raw materials, such as naphthalene, propylene oxide, titanium dioxide, and several others which I will not name, which are vital for the growth of the specialty chemical sector. The National Policy on Petrochemicals was approved by the government in 2007, and in accordance with the policy, four PCPIRs, that is the Petroleum Chemicals and Petrochemicals Investment Regions, have been approved. We have recently signed an agreement with the government of Tamil Nadu for the fourth one, and these four PCPIRs are Dahej in Gujarat, which is functioning with a total investment of about 50,000 crore, that's 500 billion rupees. As of now, the other PCPIRs in Paradip in Orissa, Visakhapatnam Kakinada region of Andhra Pradesh, Cuddalore Nagapattinam districts of Tamil Nadu are under various stages of implementation. Apart from this, my department has also a scheme for setting up of plastic parks to encourage the plastic industry, and four have already been approved in Madhya Pradesh, Odisha, Tamil Nadu and Assam. To continue from what Mr. Kothari said, our national manufacturing policy envisages increasing the share of manufacturing from the present level of about 16% to 25% of GDP by the year 2022, and along with that, creation of 100 million additional jobs in the manufacturing sector by the same year 2022. It goes without saying that the chemical and petrochemical sector would have a very, very important role to play in this endeavor. In the coming decade, the chemical industry has to promote sustainable development by investing in technology that protects the environment and stimulates growth while balancing the economic needs and the financial constraints which will always be there. I urge the industry to make efforts to adopt environmental friendly measures, including, of course, the responsible care, which about 110 Indian companies have already adopted. And research and development is the foundation of this industry. The Indian chemical sector is currently spending about 2% of the total turnover on R&D, which is pretty low by world standards. And I urge the industry to step up this to about 5% of, at least 5% of the turnover. And there would be definitely certain policy steps required in this endeavor, for which we shall work with the ICC and with the industry in the area of strengthening intellectual property rights and promoting synergy with academia, with R&D centers, manufacturers and other stakeholders. Also creating the state-of-the-art laboratory infrastructure and incentives for R&D. And the research must now include green chemistry, which we are promoting with the help of ICC, and several workshops have already been held in this subject. At this juncture, I'd like to mention a few matters that are of concern. Safety in chemical plants is a major cause of concern, and we really need to have zero tolerance in this regard. Human resource development is a prerequisite for any industry, more so for this industry. And I request the chemical and petrochemical industry to provide skill training and make the younger population fit and eligible for a productive employment. In our department, we have an organization named CIPET, which many of you know, the Central Institute of Plastics Engineering and Technology, that has been conducting courses all the way from the shop floor workers to postdoctoral, and they would be training about 600,000 people over the 10 years, 2012 to 2022, as part of the Prime Minister's National Skill Development Initiative. This is a critical area, and I urge the industry to contribute to this effort to provide the skill training and also to provide the employment. This conference would discuss topics covering almost the entire spectrum of the chemical and petrochemical sector. I look forward to the discussions over the next 2 days. Welcome you once again, the delegates from India and abroad, and wish this conference all success. Thank you.
Thank you, Secretary, sir. We are very, very happy that you're joining us for the next 2 days, and we'll be hearing all of us give our perspectives on different topics of this industry. I'm going to now request Mr. R. Gopalakrishnan, Director Tata Sons, our guest of honor, to deliver the keynote speech, sir. Mr. R. Gopalakrishnan has been a professional manager from 1967 onwards, 31 years in Unilever and 15 years in Tata. He has served in Jeddah as chairman of Unilever Arabia and Bangalore and managing director of Brooke-Bond Lipton India, and finally as vice chairman of Hindustan Levers. Currently, he is director Tata Sons, chairman of Tata Auto Component Systems in Rallis India, and the vice chairman of Tata Chemicals. He serves on the board of Tata Power, Tata Technologies, ExxonMobil India, and BP Castrol India. Mr. Gopal studied physics at St. Xavier's Calcutta, engineering at IIT Kharagpur, and attended the advanced management program at Harvard Business School. He's a past president of All India Management Association. He has taught an unusual course entitled Learning What's Not Taught at B Schools. He has authored best-selling books, some of which have been translated into many languages. The Case of the Bonsai Manager, When the Penny Drops, What the CEO Really Wants from You, and the latest one, A Comma in a Sentence. I'm sure most of us would have read at least one of them. What an honor, sir, to have you here with us, Mr. R. Gopalakrishnan, our guest of honor, to enamor us all with his extempore address. Over to you, sir.
I'm deeply grateful, Mr. Kothari, that you have invited me to come and speak here and share the dais with so many distinguished people. When you look at me, I look a bit like the chemical industry, a bit wounded, a bit misunderstood, and everybody's wondering what is going on here. Why did this fellow in this funny dress with this funny apparition arrive? I had the little accident a couple of weeks ago, just to get the mystery out of it. And luckily, I slipped and fractured my hand, but not when I was drunk, but when I was doing a healthy game of tennis. So it seems that the end effect may be the same, but how you achieved it also seems to matter. When Arup, my colleague from Tata Chemicals, invited me to come and speak, I said, I don't want to go into the usual mode of what are all the problems of the chemical industry, and taking the opportunity of the fact that the secretaries here ask for a few concessions and considerations. Those are all part of a day's work, which I'm sure ICC does very, very competently. But I wanted to stand back, and at my age, you're allowed to do that, and reflect on some challenges of this chemical industry. And although Nidhi referred to it as an extempore speech, I'm not that knowledgeable or smart. So I have a prepared speech, of which he has a copy. But luckily, I'm not going to read it for you, because nothing is worse than a speech which has been put in front of you and you read it. So I will just pluck out some of the key features of it, which I think are worth highlighting, and assuming that I have in some small way triggered an interest, Nidhi will undertake the burden of passing on the rest of the speech to you. If I have to mention the airplane ladder approach, you just say what you want to say in about 2 minutes, then this is what I would say. The chemical industry does not have a fuzzy image. It is not unfriendly to the environment, but many are prone to think that it is very fuzzy, and many are prone to think it's unfriendly to the environment. In reality, I regard the chemical industry as being one of creating human happiness. And I'm not Sri Sri Ravi Shankar. But believe me, the amount of happiness this industry has created far exceeds any other industry, and I've been associated with many during my 46-year career. And so I want to just state that the chemistry-based solutions that have been produced by this industry have enhanced human happiness more than any other industry. Now here I'm probably preaching to the converted. I mean, I see many approving nods to my statement, but that is not the image of plain Joe. When you go out and talk to them, the first thing they will tell you, as the distinguished secretary to the government said, is be careful on safety, make sure you don't discharge bad gases. And the best test of this was 46 years ago when I began my career. If I told my grandmother that I've got a job in a company which makes processed triglycerides and surfactants, she said, oh my God, what has my son done? But if I went and told her that I got a company in a soap company, she said, how wonderful, make some more nice soaps. I want to structure the content of what I have prepared this morning into four I's. First is the importance of this industry. The second is the challenge of identity in this industry. The third is its tradition of innovativeness. And the last is the challenge of inclusiveness. So the two on the right are the challenges. The two on the left are its traditions. Now, I don't want to spend too much time on emphasizing the importance of this industry to this audience. But the distinguished secretary has already referred to some numbers. It's quite staggering to think that the global chemical market is just a tad lower than the steel and the automotive market put together. It's a bit sobering to think that although India has 16% of the population of the world, we consume only 3% of the chemicals. In a sense, especially for our entrepreneurs and international delegates, that tells you the headroom that despite the image of the chemical industry being a smokestack industry, so far as this market is concerned, it is a sunrise industry. Except we are waiting for the sun to rise for some time now. And we can't predict the sunrise exactly when. The third is that this industry makes a higher contribution to the National Industrial Production Index. It is as much as 12%, which is more than the entire electricity industry. And exceeds the steel industry and the auto, or slightly a tad lower than the steel and the auto industry put together. But if you came from Mars and just read our newspapers and watched our television, and assuming you could make some sense out of what they are saying, which is a big challenge in itself, you would not think of the chemical industry as being at the vanguard of the economic progress and plans of this country, either in terms of its visibility, its effect on society, and what people say of it. I've then got a very large number of statistics, which are all encapsulated perhaps within this chart. And I think it's redundant for me to go through this chart and take you through the cartwheels. Suffice it to say that the meaning of this chart is that it is a very, very important industry. And everybody here is going to be convinced about it. And I'm not going to spend my time on it. But there's a very significant characteristic of this industry which no other industry has, at least not to my knowledge and experience. That 80% of the output of this large industry is B2B. One industry sells to the other industry. They are not consumer facing. So only 20% of this industry is consumer facing, which means it sells to end consumers. And those have a name and a face and a look about it. So if you tell somebody you are in the paint industry, they say, aha, I understand what you mean. You say you're in the tire industry, you say, aha, I know what you mean. But you say you're in the surfactants industry, and they say, well, what does that mean? And I'm talking of plain Joe, and I'm not talking of cognoscenti with PhDs in chemistry. So I want to move away from this first I with the point that you may be very, very large, but you have successfully become invisible. And that's a Houdini trick which no other industry has managed to do. This industry has not planned to do it, but it has done it. And we have to go forward from here. And therefore, I want to move to the second I, which is about identity. Now, I got such a busy chart there that none of you needs to read it. There may be some delegates here whose company names may appear there, and I have not prepared this chart. But I reflect back. I spent 31 years in Unilever. And I regard Unilever as a chemical company, which is very strongly consumer-facing. I've been in Tata now 16 years. I'm the chairman of Rallis. I'm the vice chairman of Tata Chemicals. And I regard them as industry-facing or farmer-facing industries. I serve as an independent director on the board of AkzoNobel. I regard that as facing the decorative paints or industrial sectors. And I serve on the board of Castrol, which I regard as a chemical company, which happens to face the two-wheeler and the four-wheeler industry. So I think of my entire 4 to 6 years as having been spent in the chemical industry. But when I say this to people, there's a look of disbelief. They say, have you cracked something in a refinery? Have you been in petrochemicals? And so somehow that's the image of chemical industry. And FMCG companies and paint companies are somehow, so people make profound statements like, I want to be the 10th largest, I want to be in the top 5 in the chemical industry. But you ask them, but what do you consider a chemical company? They say, oh, no, I can't include Unilever, I can't include Procter & Gamble, I will not include AkzoNobel, I'll include only certain kinds of companies. So I want to change this around based on my own experience and say, what is common between Hindustan Lever or Unilever, Rallies, AkzoNobel, Castrol, refineries, petrochemicals, plastics, tires, pharma? And the answer is, they're all in the business of providing chemistry-based solutions to enhance human happiness. And believe me, all of us know that each of those has enormously influenced human happiness. But this is not the public perception, and this is the problem of identity this industry has. Chemistry is a basic science. People say we started BSc in chemistry, MSc in chemistry. But no other basic science has given its name to a whole industry. Have you ever met anybody who says, I'm in the physics industry? Or I'm in the mathematics industry? Or I'm in the biology industry? No. This is the only one which has given its name to the entire industry that it has spawned. So you have multi-product chemical companies, I'm sure many of whom are present here, and I'm not an expert on their companies. If I take their names, it's only as a layperson. Dow, BASF, FMC, DSM, somehow they get into alphabets. It looks like a telecom company sometimes. I wonder why chemical companies, that's because they keep buying and selling companies, and they rearrange the alphabets so that nobody can pronounce them. So you get all these funny sounding companies, which are very, very famous, very successful. I mean, internationally in the stock exchange, these companies are fantastic companies. But you ask yourself what they do, and it's very difficult. Just get a job there and tell your grandmother what you do. And you'll find it so difficult to explain what exactly you do. And so they use marvelous lines, which sound very lofty, and indeed are lofty. We are working on the miracles of science. It doesn't give you a clue whether you're a pastor in a church or you're something more important. It is not as expressive as saying, I work in the Ford Motor Company, because then you know exactly what you do. Maybe we don't want to tell people exactly what we do. We have usages like, we don't make a lot of products you buy, we make a lot of the products you buy better. And you scratch your head like hell to see, is it a mosquito repellent, or what the hell is this product that they make? And that's the reason why we have, I believe, what I consider a crisis of identity. And if you tell somebody you're in one of these alphabeted companies, they wonder what you do. But you go and tell them you work in Michelin, Glaxo, Procter & Gamble, they say, aha, I know that company. And your grandmother will also say, I've heard of it, most likely. Now, is this a crisis of identity, a crisis at all? Do we need to bother about it? This industry has been around for 100 years and more. I believe, looking at the future, it is an identity issue, and I do consider it a crisis. If you look at the study of long-lasting companies, there are many studies. I have a whole string of them, Japanese companies, American companies, European companies, Indian companies. And you see what causes long life. One of them, there are 4 or 5 of them, of the answers, is you must have a strong sense of identity. Because then society understands you, you can live in harmony with society. If society do not know whether you're an octopus or a fish or a bird, then it becomes rather difficult to survive in harmony with that society for long periods of time. Therefore, as people have become more and more perplexed by this thing called the chemical industry, which could mean anything from a fine chemical company to a pharmaceutical company to a refinery. All these are chemical companies. When bad things are attributed to you, often with good reason, you will find it very difficult to defend yourself or to do something about it. And therefore, it is very important for the longevity of an institution or an industry, for plain Joe to understand who you are and not just the cognoscenti. And that is why I have put this point about identity into my speech. The third eye I want to touch upon is innovativeness. This is absolutely a sparkling star in the history of this industry. So sparkling a star that you can't keep your eyes open. You're blinded by it if you would just sit down. And it would not be appropriate for me to tell this in ICC, the miracles of what this industry has done. Probably no other industry has had such a sterling track record in the opening line that I used, enhancing human happiness. So rather than go through all the Nobel Prize winners and how many people, the usual way of measuring this, I said, let me caricature an artificial situation. Imagine that a person who lived around 1850s was pulled out from heaven or hell or wherever he is. If he's from the chemical industry, he must be in heaven, I would assume. Pull him out and put him here. Bring another person who lived around the 1920s and take today's young man, 75 years apart, and let them have a conversation on this dais and say, have you walked around Bombay City? What have you noticed? What surprised you? And in this caricature, I've chosen only one or two areas to illustrate how much change. You know, we all think the pace of change is increasing. Actually, I would like to argue the pace of change between 1850 and 1925 was far higher than between 1925 and today. But that's not the subject of my discussion, but the chemical industry exemplifies it. The man from 1850s would say, you know, I'm damn scared of falling ill. Because if I have to go surgery, they take a saw and cut me up. Now, what is this new thing you've got called an anesthetic? I've never heard of this. And the 1925 man will say, oh, you didn't know anesthetics in your time? And he will go on to say, I was almost certain, if not die of the disease itself, die of the operation that they would perform, because all sorts of germs would come, and you've got this new thing called a disinfectant. And the 1925 man will say, wow, only 75 years ago you didn't know what's a disinfectant. And therefore, the trauma of the operation itself was enough to kill you. You didn't need the disease, in a manner of speaking. So chloroform, which was invented by James Simpson as late as 1847, and carbolic acid, which was invented by Lister in 1865, are as miraculous as they have been. But today, if you tell somebody chloroform or antiseptic, it doesn't sound very, very sexy. And then comes a 1925 person's turn to speak at the seminar. And he said, you know, when I was young, I read about an economist called Robert Malthus who said everybody's going to die on this planet because the population is increasing very fast. I don't know how we're going to feed everybody. And then he says, now you tell me, Mr. 2010 person, that there are 7 billion people and you're feeding them successfully. What is this thing you call fertilizer, synthetic organic chemicals which protect plants? He's never heard of it. Because just before the 1925 person was born, there were two scientists called Fritz Haber and Carl Bosch who invented the ammonia synthesis process. Now, if I refer to ammonia synthesis process as one of the best and biggest innovations that happened to human beings, they say, no, the iPad is bigger. But to be honest, if you ask yourself, they are all in their graves, Mr. Bosch and Mr. Fisher, how many billions of people were touched by your science? I think they must get the prize compared to Steve Jobs. But you can't write a 700-page book on Carl Bosch and Fritz Haber and expect to sell it. But if you write 700 pages on Steve Jobs, you will sell it. That's the changing times. But it doesn't take away the innovativeness. And I've just taken, I could go on and on. I've collected all these stories, but certainly in this audience, it will be unnecessary. So there is an outstanding track record of innovativeness this industry has, and continues to have, I might add. But because it's invisible, it's all lost in the fog. And it rarely gets as much credit for it as perhaps it deserves, but it gets the discredit because there are many things that go wrong. And if I look at the evolution of the chemical industry, it's been around 200 years, and compare it metaphorically with the evolution of human beings, in hindsight, there are some seminal moments when something happened, and I think we are at such a seminal moment, which is the reason why I seek your indulgence to make the point. I mean, after all, first in the world of evolution, there were reptiles. And then they developed a little brain on top of the reptilian brain, and it became mammals, which went on fours. And one fine day, some species of mammal decided to stand and use only two legs and gave a new name to the other two legs. They called it two hands. And that single act of getting up on two legs and walking changed the entire blood supply system in the body. And the blood that was required for your haunches and muscles and shoulders to go that way got redirected. There was surplus blood. And it went and developed this third brain, which human beings distinctively have. They don't use it as often as the possession of the brain itself, called the neocortex, which makes us the only species of our type. And this brain, so remarkably, look at the biology behind it, the chemistry behind it, is 2% of your body weight, but consumes 25% of the energy. So people who say brain work doesn't give you exercise are not entirely right, they're only partly right. And this industry has also had its evolution. Initially, by making natural substances to produce in an industrial plant, like the synthetic indigo process. Then later on, by creating chemical substances that do not naturally occur on the earth, like a petrochemical plant. You start to do things in combinations and breakdowns. And lastly, to develop specialty chemical products to develop specific customer needs, nylon 6 and even toothbrushes and tents and stuff like that. So as this industry evolved, using the reptilian, mammalian, and neo-mammalian metaphor of human evolution, a whole new set of customer segments came up. Agriculture, manufacturing, construction. All these are consumers of chemical products. But we would describe ourselves not in those terms very often. We would describe ourselves as some mysterious set of chemical words which go, polymers that go into that, or monomers that go into something else, and so on and so forth. And I do believe the combination of the lack of identity or a fuzzy identity, the huge track record and a continuing track record of innovativeness, and the challenge to inclusiveness, which is the last point I would like to cover, requires us to do the equivalent of the species that stood up and walked on two legs and suddenly change the way the blood supply in the system would work. And I shall make a few suggestions at the end, very briefly. The details are in my paper. Which brings me to the last point that I wanted to touch upon, which is about inclusiveness. What does inclusiveness really mean? Social terms, in our countries where we live, it means giving everybody an equal place and not excluding anybody due to race, religion, etc., etc. And the chemical industry is part of a society. It cannot be disconnected from society in any way, and it doesn't intend to be disconnected from society. But gradually, its links have become a bit disconnected because somebody has described himself as a detergent industry, or somebody is paint industry, or somebody is tire industry, the pharmaceutical industry, and you don't associate, you cease to associate with their application-oriented, consumer-facing industries. if you go back 300-400 years, I think chemistry was almost a noble profession. You could either become a clergyman or a chemist. They both started with C. It was as noble as that. Somewhere down the line, in more recent years, we become the villains of the piece, despite whatever you might have achieved in the past. I mean, today, if you go anywhere in the world, you would say, what is the most revolutionary piece of technology that you have, which is changing the future of mankind? You would refer to IT, software, telecom. Can you imagine that when our grandchildren are sitting on this dais, they'll be the most vilified? Is it possible to think of a seminar where the IT, telecom are attacked squarely? But it is entirely possible to think of, you don't need a seminar for it, you get attacked anyway. The chemical industry is a constant source of attack. And this is the point I wanted to make about lack of inclusiveness. It is not a willed inclusiveness, it is a consequential and a consequent inclusiveness that we have denied ourselves somehow. Give you one example, and I'm talking at a 40,000 feet level, doesn't affect any sub-segment of this industry. Something very dramatic, I mean, 5-6 years ago, The Economist carried a very lead article about malaria in the world. And they made a statement in that, 1 out of 12 people on this planet, no, 500 million people on this planet need treatment for malaria, 500 million. We all know the United Nations has a global malaria action program, and there was a criticism in The Economist was that all the United Nations programs fail and so on and so forth. But as early as 1948, there was a scientist, Paul Hermann Muller, who in fact got the Nobel Prize for recognizing and formulating DDT's high efficiency in the control of malaria. Within 20 years, 15 years, it did a job, but it also had certain other jobs that it did which were not favorable to society. And so while DDT was a spectacular success in killing insects, and which were the main cause of malaria, they unfortunately had either unforeseen or unplanned for side effects. And Rachel Carson became a very famous person in the world, because she led this huge and successful campaign in the United States, culminating in the banning of DDT from 1972. She succeeded, and to many she is a goddess, and perhaps the originator of the environmental movement in the country, in the world. And we have many Rachel Carsons now in our country and in many other countries. But as a thinking citizen, I ask myself the question, maybe she was right. If 1 million people are dying of malaria every year, we have lost 40 million people or 50 million people since Rachel Carson succeeded. That's more than twice the number of people who died in World War II. Was there not a protocol-based way which could have been investigated at that time? But I'm sure I wasn't in the subject at that time. They must have tried in the chemical industry, but ban is what everybody wants. GMO, ban. And there are marvelous advances where the solution that chemists are well known for, protocol-based safety measures, because we don't practice it well enough, we don't explain ourselves. So, to conclude, because my time is over, I've got 2-3 minutes left, I do believe there are solutions. I've tried to identify 2 great strengths and 2 great weaknesses, and I put down some recommendations, the essence of which says that it's time that the chemical industry thought beyond the boundaries of just whichever application area they have, to reconsider and redefine its value proposition so that society can begin to understand them a lot better. I'm not going to go through all of it, but to state the obvious, which all of you in this room know, but everybody, plain Joes, don't know, from being traditional chemical manufacturers, which is the way we tend to describe ourselves on the left side, you start to move to be solution providers, and you try to move to being consumer-centric. That is the journey. Now, many companies have done this. It's not that this is a very intelligent or distinctive idea which nobody has thought of. And I could go through the list of companies who have successfully made this, but it's a struggle. I think I'm not going to go through all the stuff in the interest of the time and to help the organizers complete on time. I would just like to conclude by saying, if the leadership in the chemical industry is to address this point about being more inclusive and being a sharper identity and establishing the consumer connect, it's easier to make a speech on it than to actually do it. Chemical industry people are remarkably insensitive, and I say this as a member of the industry, to the final consumer benefit. Unless you're a consumer goods company, the connect doesn't come to you. The leadership challenge is enormous. It is something that will